You know, there are lots of what we call urban legends that float around the internet. And they tell things and they set forth stories and they make heroes, and they're false. One such made its internet rounds a few years ago about a young student named Albert Einstein, who allegedly refuted an atheist's denial of God's existence. Well, that was a false statement. That didn't happen. And if it had of, it would have been really nice, but it did not happen. Well, a comment was made from a website which debunks those urban legends that says, here's the problem with faith. That which articles of it can't be proved, or rather that which are articles of faith can't be proved. And it says, according to our dictionary, faith is firm belief in something for which no proof exists. Now, that's according to the dictionary they quote. Those who are convinced of the existence of God, therefore, have no incontrovertible, irrefutable answer to anyone who challenges them to provide the evidence of the veracity of their belief system's tenets. End quote. So the writer says, or at least views, faith as something like wishful thinking. Let me ask you this. What would you say of a diver who stands on a 30 or 40 foot cliff looking down into the serene waters below and decides to dive off that cliff, and that water is only 5 feet deep and there are lots of rocks beneath the surface? That would be rather foolish, wouldn't it? Did you know that's the way most people view faith? That it's a leap in the dark, or it's a dive off a 30-foot cliff hoping that everything's going to be all right when you get there. That's the way most people view faith. The man who dives into that situation is really foolish. That is a leap in the dark. That is wishful thinking. That is a wrong guess. And that's what most people, and especially this commentator who said we have a problem with faith, that there is no evidence to answer anyone who challenges us to prove the truth of our belief. Now, suppose that man on the cliff, 30, 40, 50 foot cliff above this serene water, would look down there and think, you know, that would be nice to be able to dive off this cliff, but I need to check first and see if that water is safe. And he goes down and he checks, and sure enough, the water is safe. So he goes back up and he makes his dive into that serene, beautiful water. That is doing something by faith, according to the Bible, because he had evidence that the water was safe. Therefore, he took the dive. The man who takes a dive without knowing anything, without having evidence, without having knowledge, is going on wishful thinking. That's the way this writer views faith. But the faith of which the Bible speaks is based upon evidence. And I want to add knowledge of evidence. You see, people say, well, if we know it or we can see it, it's not, faith has nothing to do with it. They think faith is wishful thinking. Faith is a guess. Faith is a leap in the dark, and that's sometimes why they call it a leap of faith. That means they're leaping into the dark, not knowing what's going to happen at the end. Bible faith's not that way. Bible faith is based upon evidence that comes from knowledge. All faith, whether true or false, is based upon evidence. Without evidence, there is absolutely no faith. A study of Hebrews 11 indicates that. We've been over that chapter before, and you know what it says? By faith, Abel offered unto God a more excellent sacrifice than Cain. God testifying of his gifts, and by it he being dead yet speaketh. By faith Abel offered. Romans 10:17 says, so then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Faith is based upon the Word of God, a knowledge of the Word of God, and an understanding of the Word of God. That's what the word hearing means, an understanding. And faith is based upon that, and Abel offered by faith. That's in Hebrews 11:4. In Hebrews 11:7, we are told that by faith Noah, being warned of God of things not seen as yet, moved with fear and prepared an ark to the saving of his house, by which he condemned the world and became the heir of righteousness, which is by faith. By faith, Noah, being warned of God, moved with fear. His faith moved him. God told him that the end of all flesh was coming. God told him to build an ark, and Noah moved at the word of God. By faith, Abraham, when he was called to go out into a country which he should after receive for an inheritance, went out. He obeyed, not knowing whither he went. In all of these cases that you'll read about in the 11th chapter of the book of Acts, I'm sorry, the 11th chapter of the book of Hebrews, in all of those cases, you'll find that the faith of those people was based upon evidence. Bible faith is based upon credible evidence. It is not a leap in the dark, a dive off a cliff hoping that everything will be all right at the end. Bible faith is based upon knowledge of the evidence that is before us. There is no problem with faith, as our commentator says. The thesis of John's gospel, he says in John 20, 30 and 31, is this. Many other signs truly did Jesus in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book, but these are written that ye might believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, and that believing ye might have life through his name. That is John's gospel's thesis. That's why he wrote it. These are written that ye might believe. Jesus did a lot of things, he said. They're not written in his book. But here is written sufficient things. Here are written sufficient things to produce faith in Jesus Christ. That's why he wrote his book. One who accepts that does so based upon Christ's life, the evidence of it that's presented there by John. It is foolish to say that faith is firm belief in something for which no proof exists. Think about that. Faith, according to that commentator, says, is firm belief in something for which no proof exists. Well, Jesus proved his claims by his miracles. In fact, he talks about some other witnesses to his deity in John the 5th chapter. There he talked about the testimony of John the Immerser, who pointed him out as the Lamb of God, which takes away the sin of the world. Jesus said that you sent unto John, and he bore witness of me. That's in John 5:33. He had previously said in John 5:31, if I bear witness of myself, my witness is not true. He's not saying that what he says about himself is not true. He's saying, in fact, he's referring to the law of Moses, that in the mouth of two or three witnesses, every word shall be established. And he's saying, if I come to you, and I'm the only one who bears witness of myself, then he says, you should not consider my witness true. But then he goes ahead to point out that there are others who bear witness of him. There is another that beareth witness of me, he said, and he was talking about John. Then in verse 35, he says, he, John, was a burning and shining light. This is in John the 5th chapter. And ye were willing for a season to rejoice in his light. But now look at verse 36. But I have a greater witness than that of John. Here's another witness. He said, I bear witness to myself. John bears witness of me. Now I have a greater witness than John. For the works which the Father hath given me to finish, the same works that I do, bear witness of me that the Father has sent me. And that's exactly what John, who wrote the book of John, meant when he said, many other signs truly did Jesus that are not written in this book, but these are written that ye might believe. And Jesus said, the works which the Father give me to finish, these works bear witness of me. Here is evidence. We have knowledge of those works. Read the scriptures. Read the scriptures. And we have knowledge of those things. Those claims were faithfully, Jesus' claims, were faithfully recorded by inspired men for us for all time to come. Someone says, well, yeah, but they're just written down. We weren't there. We didn't see them. Well, listen to this. In our system, judiciary system in this country and in our state, testimony in a court trial is given by credible witnesses, and they are cross-examined over and over until the truth comes out. They are tested. Their testimony is tested, and their testimony has to be corroborated by evidence. We all understand that, don't we, in our country? And then when that trial is over, when all the testimony is in, when the evidence has been presented, it is committed to permanent record. And that's done so by a court reporter. And once the judgment is rendered, all of the testimony in that court case is available for anyone to read. The same is true with the Bible. Jesus performed his miracles. Jesus had many witnesses testifying to his deity in his day. There is not a contradiction in the entire New Testament, in the entire Bible for that matter. There is not a contradiction. There is not anything that disproves his claims. And he was tried, severely tried, not only by his enemies, but even by his friends. And those things have been written down, and that is the evidence upon which we base our faith, the Word of God. So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. Now, what does this commentator we read, upon what does he base his faith? He says, faith is firm belief in something for which no proof exists. Now, you think about this. Having talked about our judiciary system, back in the 1920s, you probably remember the Scopes monkey trial. You don't remember it. You're not that old. Neither am I. But we know what we're talking about, don't we? It's historical fact. Scopes monkey trial. When evolution was put on trial in Tennessee, Clarence Darrow represented the evolutionists in that trial. Clarence Darrow was a very famous trial lawyer of that period. Not a one of us was there. There's nobody, I don't suppose anybody living today, who was at that trial, who even saw it. How do we know that trial took place? How do we know? History, it's written down. Do you suppose that commentator who said that faith is belief in something for which no proof exists, do you suppose he believes in that Scopes monkey trial? I would say he does. And he would say, yes, it's a matter of history. Then I would say the same thing about the New Testament. It's a matter of history. The Bible is not a history book, but it deals with historical facts. Historical evidence, the evidence of the Son of God. If I were to take off heading east, could I reach the moon? According to this fella, of course I couldn't, but he would say I was doing that by faith because I'm doing something for which no proof exists. I'm going east. There's no proof exists that I can reach the moon by going east. But according to this commentator, that's just a leap in the dark. That's faith, he calls it. But that's not faith. It's called foolishness. The world defines faith as a leap in the dark. But faith is based upon evidence, as we said before, upon the knowledge of evidence. It's not a stab in the dark. The commentator who wrote that believers in God have no incontrovertible, irrefutable answer to anyone who challenges them doesn't understand that his own existence bespeaks the existence of God. David said, the heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament showeth his handiwork. That's in Psalms 19, verse 1. And Paul declared that this universe and everything in it testifies, there's your testimony, there's your proof, testifies to the existence of a creator. That creator is God. In Romans 1, Paul wrote, and he talked about the decline of man, the descent of man from his pristine purity, the way God created him, to the lowest level of wickedness to which he descended on his own. And Paul deals with that in Romans chapter 1 and describes that descent beginning in verse 18 through the end of the chapter. And in verse 19 or 18, he had said that the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold or hinder the truth in unrighteousness, because, here's why the wrath of God is revealed, because that which may be known of God is manifest in them. The fellow who says there is no God is denying his own existence. His own existence bespeaks the existence of God, our Creator. That which may be known of God is manifest in them, for God hath showed it unto them. How did God show that? Here's the way. You see, he gave us intelligence and expects us to use our intelligence. And he says in verse 20, Paul writes, Romans 1, for the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made. What's that? Even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. The invisible things of him are clearly seen and are understood by what is made. And those invisible things of him that are clearly seen and understood by the things made are seen and understood from the creation of the world. That's not talking about time-wise, that's talking about from the fact of the creation of the world. The world is here. Where did it come from? The universe is here. Where did it come from? Didn't just happen. Scientists will tell you that matter cannot generate itself. Man can change matter, but man can't create matter. And matter, scientists will tell you, is not eternal. So where did it come from? Had to come from what was eternal. What was that? That's God. The invisible things of him. What are those invisible things? His eternal power and his Godhead. The fact that he is deity, he is God. That's what's seen. You look at the heavens. That's what David said. The heavens declare the glory of God. The firmament showeth his handiwork. There's the proof. There's the evidence of God. So don't say like that dumb commentator that faith is firm belief in something for which no proof exists. I believe in God, and I can believe in God because, unlike so many people in the world today, you and I can exercise common sense. Common sense tells me that when I drive down the street and I see a house, I know somebody built that house. That house didn't just happen. Somebody built the house. I know that. The existence of that house proves that it had a builder. Somebody built it. In Hebrews 3:3, the writer there says, every house is builded by some man, but he that built all things is God. Now, if you and I can understand that the house in which we live, or the house across the street, or down the corner, if we can understand that somebody built that house, can we understand that? Sure we can. If we can understand that that house tells me somebody built it, didn't just happen, didn't grow up there, then can we not look at our world, the earth upon which we live, the planets, the stars, the moon, the sun, and say, somebody built that. It didn't build itself. Didn't just happen. There is proof. There is the proof that the commentator says doesn't exist for faith. I'm not even sure that commentator exists. Why not accept the heavens and the earth as sufficient truth of the fact that God created the heaven and the earth, as sufficient proof of the eternal builder? Yes, every house is builded by some man, Houses come and go, and men come and go. But he that built all things is God, who created man. There is such a thing as true faith and false faith. Whether true or false, faith is always based upon evidence. A false faith is based upon false evidence. And that's seen in the case of Jacob, when his son sold their older brother, Joseph, into slavery. Turn over into Genesis, the 37th verse, you'll find there that to cover their wickedness, well, they at first wanted to kill their brother, and they decided to put him in a pit and hold him, wait and decide what to do with him. Reuben persuaded them not to kill him. And so along came some traders going toward Egypt, and they sold him to those traders. Now, how could they cover their sin, their wickedness, from their father? How could they keep him from knowing what they had done? Well, they took Joseph's coat of many colors that his father had given him, and Genesis 37:31 says they dipped it in the coat. They dipped the coat into the blood of a kid or a goat. And they brought that coat to Jacob, their father and Joseph's father, and they asked him, "Tell us whether this be thy son's coat." And he recognized it as Joseph's coat in Genesis 37:32. Now, when Jacob observed the bloodstained coat, he said, "It is my son's coat. An evil beast hath devoured him. Joseph is without doubt rent in pieces." That's Genesis 37:33. What now did Jacob believe? He believed Joseph was dead. His son had been devoured by a beast. Why did he believe that? Well, he had looked at some evidence. His other sons came to him and said, they didn't even say, "Here's Joseph's coat." They said, "Tell us whether this be Joseph's coat." Of course, they knew it was. And they knew, their father knew it was. It was the coat he had made him, a coat of many colors that he had given him. And here's the evidence. Here is his son's coat, and it's covered with blood. What else is he to think? Joseph's not there. Joseph's been killed. And this bloody coat proves it. He believed that. That was his faith. That was what he believed. Was it just a leap of faith? Was it a shot in the dark? Was it a guess? No. No, it wasn't. It was a conclusion that was brought about because of the evidence that was presented to him. Was he sincere? Yes, he was. Jacob was sincere. Was his faith true? No. He was wrong. He was mistaken. Why was his faith not true? Why was he wrong? Because his faith was based upon false evidence. You see, all faith, whether true or false, is based upon evidence. If it is based upon false evidence, the faith is false. The Methodist Discipline says in Article 9, "Wherefore that we are justified by faith only is a most wholesome doctrine and very full of comfort." And do you know how many thousands of people believe that doctrine and are sincere in that? And they read that and they say, "Yes, I believe that. We are saved by faith only." Are they sincere? Probably. Do they truly believe that? Yes. Is their faith or belief true? No. Why? Because that's false. Their faith is based upon something false. And so their faith is false. The Methodist discipline is false. It's not the word of God. It's the word of men. And so their faith is false. Now, further proof that he believed Joseph was dead is seen in these words. And Jacob rent his clothes and put sackcloth upon his loins and mourned for his son many days. And all his sons and all his daughters rose up to comfort him, but he refused to be comforted. And he said, I will go down into the grave unto my son mourning. Thus his father wept for him. Genesis 37, 34, and 35. Very sad, tragic, poignant words there recorded by Moses in Genesis. Because of Jacob's deep grief, the grief of a father, and you can almost feel the grief of this man who mourns for his son. What was the source of his deep grief? It was what he believed. What did he believe? He believed Joseph was dead, and his faith was based upon the evidence presented by his other sons, and he was wrong. He found out later that he was wrong, and he was happy. He rejoiced. You know, people who have their faith based upon false evidence, false doctrines, such as the Baptist manual or the Methodist discipline, the Catholic's catechism, people who have their faith based upon those things, if they ever learn the truth, ought to rejoice and be thankful that they were snatched from the fires of hell, because those doctrines will lead people to hell. Jacob rejoiced. He was happy to see his son, finally, a few years later. But at this point, he's very saddened. Well, all of this is true with biblical faith. Bible faith is based upon true evidence. When one reads and understands the will of God expressed in the Bible and believes that word, he has faith that is based upon written evidence from eyewitnesses. Jesus told his apostles, he said, "Ye are witnesses. Ye shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and unto the uttermost parts of the earth." Paul said in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, he said that there were above 300 who saw Jesus after his resurrection. All of the apostles saw him. And finally, Paul said, "And last of all, he was seen of me also as one born out of due time." Jesus was seen after his resurrection. They were witnesses. These are the eyewitnesses. And we have the word of the eyewitnesses in the New Testament. One who reads, understands the will of God expressed in the Bible, believes that word, has faith that is based upon or written evidence from eyewitnesses. Just as the Scopes monkey trial can be believed today from the written record of it. So then, faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Faith is not a leap in the dark which cannot be proven. It is conviction based upon things not seen. And not only is it conviction, but it is the evidence of things not seen. Hebrews 11:1 says, "Now faith is the substance of things hoped for. It stands under and supports things that we hope for. It is the evidence of things not seen." Faith is produced by credible evidence, and faith itself becomes evidence. It is evidence of that which is not seen. Jesus Christ died for you. That's what the Bible teaches. Jesus Christ wants you to be saved. That's what the Bible teaches. Jesus Christ proved his claims, and credible witnesses have written down his claims. And he wants you to be saved. And if you're not a Christian, you can be by believing in him. That's faith based upon evidence of the Bible, not a leap in the dark. Repenting of your sins, confessing your faith in Him, and being baptized. If you need to do that, will you come while we stand and sing?